Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper, beginning with an important news on page number 1 of the Delhi edition of The Hindu. And this newspaper article is relevant for your prelims as well as GS paper 2 and 3. 7 out of 10 seats sold on flights to smaller cities. And this newspaper article talks about a scheme called UDAN. UDAN, which stands for Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik. Now in 2016, a scheme was launched, UDAN, Regional Connectivity Scheme. And this regional connectivity scheme was launched to develop the regional aviation market in this country. And this scheme is the component of our National Civil Aviation Policy of 2016. The objective is to make flying affordable. But how can we make flying affordable? Is by providing connectivity. But there are various airports in this country which are developed. Delhi Airport, Mumbai Airport, Bangalore, Hyderabad, so on and so forth. How can we make flying affordable is by providing connectivity to unserved airports or those airports which are underserved. How can we improve the connectivity to these unserved and underserved airports? Is reviving the existing airstrips, reviving the existing airports so that persons in these regional towns are able to make affordable flights. This scheme is applicable on flights covering distance between 200 to 800 kilometers. That means those flight distances which are in the distance of 200 to 800 kilometers, UDAN scheme is applicable to those areas. However, one important fact for your prelims, there is no lower limit for hilly areas, for island, remote areas or security sensitive regions. But how does this scheme work? This UDAN Regional Connectivity Scheme is implemented by Airports Authority of India. That means Airports Authority of India, which comes under Ministry of Civil Aviation, is the implementing agency of this UDAN scheme. But how does this scheme work? There are two components. One is component number one, to develop new and enhance the existing airports so that we can increase the number of flights. That's the first component of this scheme. We will develop new airports, and wherever airports are there, but we'll have to enhance these existing airports, providing more airstrips or better airstrips as much as possible. The second component is, we can call it reservation of seats, for example. How does it happen? Under this scheme, the airlines what they have to do, they have to reserve a minimum number of UDAN seats. That means if the airline capacity is, let's say, 100, 50 seats out of this 100 are to be reserved, and the price for these seats will be 2500 rupees per hour of flight. That means, let's say, for example, from an airport A to B, the distance is 800 kilometers. That means it will come under UDAN scheme, and it will take 1 hour to make this flight duration. That means 50 seats on this airline will be reserved for 2500 per hour flight. But how will the airlines be compensated? Airlines will be compensated by the center as well as the respective state government. So whatever money you're losing by reserving these 50% of the seats at 2500 per hour of flight, the compensation will be provided by the center as well as the state government. And the data showed, the Hindu shows, that they filed an RTI application, and this RTI application revealed that 7.5 lakh seats were reserved under these UDAN scheme. And out of these 7.5 lakh seats, 5.24 lakh seats were sold. That means there is much demand, much better demand for these airline tickets going into remote, hilly, island or security sensitive areas. That is one thing that this newspaper article talks about. But if you look at UDAN, there are some problems with UDAN as well. For example, the implementation pace is very slow. There are 40 unserved. There are 15 underserved airports in this country. And these are still not ready for operations. That's another problem with UDAN. There are some airports which are owned by state governments. There are some airports which are owned by the private players, and they are very hesitant in participating in this UDAN scheme. Why? Because they have very less to gain because of this regional connectivity scheme. Why? Because under this regional connectivity scheme, the flights which are operating under UDAN, they are exempt from paying landing charges, parking charges. On top of that, the state government is required to pay to provide for land, security, fire services, that too free of cost. That is another challenge in UDAN scheme. However, there may be something good coming out of it. We have seen that these routes which come under the UDAN scheme, there is a steady rise in the number of passengers, particularly to Northeast. And that is how we can generate interest. When air connectivity increases, we can see a large footfall of tourists entering into these areas. That means regional tourism will also be given a boost under this UDAN scheme. So what was the news? 7 out of 10 seats sold on flights to smaller cities. And for that, we need to understand what is this UDAN scheme, when was it launched, what was the objective, what are the provisions, who is the implementing authority, and ultimately, what is the mechanism, what are the two important components under this regional connectivity scheme, as well as what is the problem lying right now. Let's look at another important news. Democracy is under threat, says Chief Election Commissioner. From what? Black money and fake news. There was a symposium which was addressed by Chief Election Commissioner O.P. Rawat. And O.P. Rawat in this speech said that there is a rise of fake news, data theft, data harvesting, profiling takes place, and democracy in the world is facing a very potent threat. What Chief Election Commissioner recommended is that media, particularly newspapers, should have regular columns or articles, and these regular columns should highlight the fake news stories of that week. That is how we are going to address this menace called fake news. Chief Election Commissioner also talked about state funding of elections, but state funding of election is not an option according to Chief Election Commissioner, because the current law is inadequate to counter this black money. That is what Chief Election Commissioner said. At this symposium, former Chief Election Commissioner S.Y. Qureshi also talked about, and he spoke about something called Democracy Index. Let's look at what this Democracy Index is all about. Democracy Index is an index that is compiled by Economic Intelligence Unit. And this Economic Intelligence Unit is based out of United Kingdom. This index was first produced in the year 2006. And it categorizes countries as four, or into four categories. One category is full democracy, flawed democracy, hybrid democracy, and authoritarian regimes. And this democracy index, which is compiled by EIU, has categorized India as a flawed democracy. Why? Because these two problems. What is the problem? Criminalization of politics and money power in Indian elections. These are the two factors responsible for the categorization of Indian democracy into the category of a flawed democracy. That's what S.Y. Qureshi talks about. But how does this democracy index come to this conclusion or categorize countries as full democracy, hybrid, flawed democracy, so on and so forth? They look at categories such as what is the political culture in a country, the civil liberties that are available to the citizens of that country, pluralism. These and many other factors, there are 60 indicators on the basis of which democracy index categorizes the countries into these four categories. So that's an important index and can be a relevant question for your prelims examination, because we have seen increasingly over the past many years these indexes or reports that are released by foreign institutions, they have been asked by the UPSC exams. Now let's look at a news item on page number 4 of the Delhi edition of the Hindu. It talks about python is rescued from the Kutub complex. Now which python is this? It's an Indian rock python and can be an important question for your prelims examination. This Indian rock python is found in most of Indian mainland. Very important statement, but excluding northeast region where this Indian rock python is not found, and it is also not found in the Indian islands. But in Indian mainland, this Indian rock python is found. But what are the characteristics of this Indian rock python? How can you differentiate or distinguish this Indian rock python from, let's say, viper? We can distinguish it because of its large size. That's one characteristic. Dark but irregular patches on the skin. It has a pinkish head. And its locomotion is slow. These are the characteristics of Indian rock python. But basically, a very important statement for your prelims, this Indian rock python is a nocturnal species. And is usually non-offensive. These are some of very important facts about Indian rock python. But lastly, what is the IUCN status of Indian rock python? It is near threatened. That means we have to conduct another regular periodic surveys to check the status of Indian rock python. The status is near threatened. Call for policy. action in diabetes prevention management, the global burden of disease study 2016. What it has shown, it was released and it points out that diabetes has increased more rapidly in India, but it has increased more rapidly in less developed states of the country. And if this is not checked, it will take a very heavy toll in the coming decades on India's healthcare system. But what we need to understand is what is going to be the way forward. For diabetes, we have to promote healthy and active lifestyle. That's one thing. We have to have interventions to prevent obesity. We have to provide public facilities to increase physical activity. What we also need to do, we need to tax junk foods more and more so that these junk foods become unaffordable for the common public. And this will go a long way in reducing the numbers. But most importantly, we need to create awareness. If you look at the changing trend of prevalence of diabetes from 1990 to 2016, we have seen massive increase in the patients suffering from diabetes, and possibly India is the diabetes capital of the world. So that is something that we need to understand right now. These are the suggestions or way forward for the diabetes program. PM launches cleanliness campaign. Now let us look at what this cleanliness campaign is all about. Swachhata Hi Seva. Cleanliness is Service campaign was launched by Prime Minister Modi. And this Swachhata Hi Seva campaign was launched to promote greater public participation, so that the vision of Mahatma Gandhi of a clean India is realized. This Swachhata Hi Seva will continue till Mahatma Gandhi's birth anniversary, which falls next month. And this campaign is coordinated by Union Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. And please understand, this drinking water and sanitation is also the convening ministry responsible for the Swachh Bharat mission. So this cleanliness campaign was launched by Prime Minister Modi, wherein he took up a broom and he cleaned a school which was named after B.R. Ambedkar, the architect of Indian Constitution. Now let me dispel one myth. There is a myth perpetrated by the experts on civil services examination that on Sundays we don't have editorials, we don't have columns. So it is better not to read these columns on Sundays. This is half truth. On page number 13 of the Delhi edition, you will see at the bottom, on most Sundays, we see a column written by Rajeev Bhargava, who is India's foremost social scientist. So whenever you have time, please go through these articles, opinion columns written by Rajeev Bhargava, right now professor of the Center for the Study of Developing Societies in Delhi, and he is the best when it comes to your answers for your essay, for the society aspect of your GS paper 1, can be relevant for your ethics as well. If you have time, please Google search Rajeev Bhargava, the Hindu, and you can have a look at his articles which he has written for more than a year now in the Hindu newspaper. And let's discuss what Rajeev Bhargava has to say today. When five intellectuals, poets, lawyers were arrested for Bhima Koregaon violence by the police, the Supreme Court played a very important role and ordered the house arrest of these public intellectuals. Justice Chandrachur, who was part of the bench which ordered the house arrest and not the formal arrest of these intellectuals, he said, "Dissent is the safety valve of democracy." Rajeev Bhargava adds one more thing. He says, "Dissent is not only the safety valve of democracy, but it is vital for meaningful social life." He says, "Societies stultify or societies lose their enthusiasm when everybody agrees with everybody. When everybody agrees with everybody, it is not a society. We have to create a society where we disagree with each other as well." That's what Voltaire said. "I disagree with what you say, but I will defend till death your right to say it." That's the culture that we need to have in a society, and that is how society grows. If everybody would have agreed with everybody, we would still have been following the system where people said earth is flat. It is only when people disagreed that now we come to a situation wherein we say that earth is not flat, it is something called oblate spheroid. When people disagreed with each other, that is how we had scientific developments in the society. And that is how people who are an integral part of the society, the citizens, they should be allowed to disagree with each other. Whether right or wrong, whether pleasant or unpleasant, views must be expressed. And the orthodoxy, whether it is social orthodoxy, political orthodoxy or religious orthodoxy, it must be challenged. That is the only way to publicly identify and remove social, political and economic deficiencies that we have in the society, writes Rajeev Bhargava. Rajeev Bhargava says that it is known to everybody that we have Adivasis, we have poor landless individuals in this country whose lands have been confiscated by the greedy corporates. And ultimately they are crying for their land, they are begging for their land. And it is in this context that we see some of our conscientious citizens, they speak up. They speak up against this injustice and they disagree from the official narrative. They disagree from the official stand taken by the governments. And in return, what we do, we arrest these dissenters. But that is not what democracy is all about. There was an American judge who said it is an internal temptation of a government to arrest a speaker rather than correct the conditions about which he complains. So if people are complaining, dissenting about the Maoist atrocities, if there are people who are crying that government has forcibly acquired their lands, we have to look at the message rather than arresting those individuals who are shooting this message. But if you look at history, Rajeev Bhargava says India has a glorious tradition of dissent. We have seen how the great Magadha intellectuals of their time, the Upanishadic thinkers, Buddha was dissenter who challenged the Vedic ritualism. The Tamil poet Sivavakkiyar, who was deeply critical of the caste hierarchy. 12th century Kannada poet Basavana, who rejected the gender and caste discrimination. Kabir, Ravidas, Guru Nanak, they all refused the then contemporary society, the norms of that society. And when they refused to accept that, when they became dissenters, the great dissenters, they laid the foundation of self-discovery and liberation. And that is what we have to become today as well. 19th century India, Rajeev Bhargava writes, saw Dalit women, they openly opposed the patriarchy. That's what Muktabai, who was the student of Savitri Bai Phule, who said, let that religion where only one person is privileged and the rest are deprived perish from the earth, and let it never enter our minds to be proud of it. These are very important quotes that you can write in your essay as well and can fetch you more marks. Swami Dayanand Saraswati, Dabolkar, so on and so forth, these have also been the dissenters of the past and the present. And that is what Rajeev Bhargava feels. He feels that there is a social value of religious and political dissent. Dissenters of the past in India were great moral agitators, introducing social, intellectual, spiritual turbulence in public life. And that is what we require. We don't require conformity in the society. We require an element of disagreement, dissent. And that is how we can become a stable society. Beautiful essay. Please read this. Incorporate some of the points mentioned by Rajeev Bhargava. That is surely going to help you in your essay. Let's look at another thing. Researchers dive in to restore coral ecosystems. Page number 14 of the Delhi edition of the Hindu. What are these coral reefs? We call them rainforests of oceans, and they are one of the most diverse ecosystems on earth and play a very, very important role in maintaining the marine biodiversity. But increasingly we see these coral reefs, they are under challenge, and one challenge is coral bleaching. What is this coral bleaching? If this is the sea, when the sea surface temperature increases, coral bleaching takes place. When coral bleaching takes place, because these corals are very, very sensitive, ultimately it affects our marine biodiversity. If you look at India, coral reefs are only seen in some locations. For example, Gulf of Mannar, Gulf of Kutch, Lakshadweep Islands, Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now, what has happened, and what is this newspaper article talking about? There is an agency called National Center for Coastal Research. This National Center for Coastal Research comes under Ministry of Earth Sciences. And what it did, it conducted a mapping of corals for Gulf of Mannar, Kutch, Andaman and Nicobar, Lakshadweep. And from a period 2000 and 2005, they found that less than 40% of these coral reefs in India are still alive. But ultimately what happened, since this was a startling result for the organization, from 2005 to present, there is a team which is actively working with Department of Science and Technology. They have surveyed the areas in Lakshadweep and transplanted these corals, and it has ultimately resulted in a situation where this region has seen a restoration of live corals. So that's a big, big thing that has happened, and let's hope this development continues. But to understand this newspaper article, you need to understand what coral reefs are, where are they found, and what is this organization, and which ministry is part of this, or which ministry oversees this National Center for Coastal Research. Now let us look at some of the facts for your prelims. International Coastal Cleanup Day. This ICC, or International Coastal Cleanup Day, was started by Ocean Conservancy. The year was 1986. The objective was that how will we engage the volunteers so that these volunteers can collect the debris, or should we say the marine debris, such as garbage, plastic. And it is through this community participation that we are in a position that coastal cleanup is becoming a reality. And why are we discussing this today can be an important statement for your prelims. It is celebrated annually, that too on the third Sunday of September. Very important statement and can be asked in your examination. Now let us look at some of the questions that can be asked in your prelims examination. Please answer these questions by writing in comments under the comment section, and I'll tell you the answers tomorrow in the next session. Which of the following is related to trade disputes between India and United States of America? Option A, is it compulsory licensing? Option B, is it CATSA? Option C, is it LEMO or COMCASA? Please have a look at the question and read it carefully. I'm talking about trade disputes between India and USA, which is the right answer. While looking at this question, you can also have a look at the answer on our website, freeisprep.byjus.com. Another important question . Which of the following is responsible for coral bleaching in the oceans? Is it chlorine? Is it hydrochloric acid? Is it carbonic acid? None of the above. Please try and answer these questions by dropping in your answers under the comment section and we can get back to you. These were the only important news in today's daily edition of the Hindu newspaper. If you're liking this initiative, once again, please like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and never miss an update. Thank you for being with us. Have a great day.